Hello everyone and welcome to the CAN communication lesson. Here is the agenda of these following videos that will be uploaded to my channel. So we will see a bit of history about CAN, make a short introduction of the CAN features, CAN bus and CAN physical layer and so on. We'll see some applications, some CAN connectors and so on. So you can pause the video and see what is the agenda. So let's start with the history. In 1983, Robert Bosch started the development of the CAN bus, and the official release was in 1986. In 1987, the first CAN controller chips were introduced by Intel, and shortly after, Philips produced CAN controllers also. In 1991, CAN 2.0A and CAN 2.0B is published, and also in that year the first production vehicle to use CAN is Mercedes-Benz W140. In 93 ISO published the CAN as a standard. In 2012 we see that Bosch also releases the CAN flexible data rate, which increase the speed of the CAN communication. The acronym CAN stands for Controller Area Network. So in theory, it is a network of controllers. I have given here some explanations what communication is and what protocol is. CAN uses a message-oriented transmission protocol. Every frame will have an identifier and we know who sent that message. And there is no addressing mode. So there are no defined addresses, just defined messages. CAN bus is a broadcast type bus, which means that all nodes can hear when something is transmitted on the bus. Every node is a master. The bus uses non-return to zero and bit stuffing mechanism. In practice, the CAN network is usually based on a line topology with linear bus. So here is the linear bus. We see here how the nodes are connected to the bus. ISO 11898 requires a cable with a nominal impedance of 120 ohms. Therefore you should use 120 ohms resistor for termination. This statement is valid only for high speed CAN. You need to use termination resistor to remove signal reflection and to ensure the bus gets correct DC levels. We can extend the network to 1 kilometer if we use low speed of 10 kilobits per second, and the network can be of 40 meters if we use the 1 megabit speed. We can have 110 nodes per bus. This is a physical limitation, but ISO specifies a maximum of 32 CAN nodes. The maximum bus speed for CAN 2.0A and B is 1 megabit per second. For CAN flexible data rate is 5 megabit per second, and the minimum bus speed is 10 kilobits per second. Physical signal transmission in a CAN network is based on differential signal transmission. You can see here the differential transmission. When we have a dominant bus level, that will correspond to a logical zero, and when we have a recessive bus level, that corresponds to a logical one. Some applications. As we saw from the history, the development of the CAN was made for passenger cars, but nowadays you'll see it used in agriculture equipment, aviation, industrial automation, medical devices, and so on. Here in this picture we see a car that has not only a CAN network, but also an Ethernet network, a FlexRay network, a LIM network, and a MOS network. So not all the nodes inside the car are communicating using the CAN protocol. And also inside the car you will have routers that will route the signal from one network to another network. So another note here is that inside the car you can have multiple CAN clusters. So a CAN cluster is composed of a number of nodes. but the clusters are separated from one another. So let's say you want to build a robot. For that robot, maybe you'll use one embedded system that has an STM32 microcontroller to control the arms. CAN connectors. There is no standard at all for the CAN bus connectors, but in practice, we encounter the following connectors. We have the D-Sub 9 pin, which is proposed by CAN in automation, which have the CAN low on the second pin and the CAN high on the seventh pin. We can have 5 pin used by device net, we see in this picture, and where the CAN high and CAN low is located. We can have 6 pin Deutsch connector. So this is how it looks and where the CAN is. This is not really a CAN connector, but an OBD2 connector. I put it here because I will use it in my practice example, and I want to show you that the CAN high is on 6 pin and the CAN low is on 14 pin. The oscillator of the CAN, according to the ISO, looks like this. So the CAN transceiver will take some part of the physical layer. Also, we have the CAN controller that will take the physical signaling and the data link layer. And the application layer, some part is in the controller and the other part is inside the software. So, frame types. There are 4 types of frames on CAN. We have the data frame, remote frame, overload frame, and error frame. So let's take them one by one. Data frame. The data frame can be of type standard or extended. So let's see what we have in the standard data frame. We have one bit to indicate the start of frame. This bit is always 0. Then we have the identifier. The identifier is a unique ID which also represents the message priority. So the bus arbitration will be made based on this identifier. Then we have the remote transmission request, which must be dominant 0 for data frames and receive 1 for remote request frames. After that, we have the ID bit, which stands for identifier extension bit. This must be dominant 0 for base frame format. So the standard format that we see here. Then we have a reserved bit. The data length code, how many bytes will be transmitted, the data field, so it will be indicated by these 4 bits. We have the data field. If the DLC is 0, then nothing will be in here. If the DLC is 8, then we'll have 8 bytes transmitted in the data field. Then we have 15 bits for the CRC. The CRC is calculated by the controller based on what is in front. Then we have 1 bit for CRC delimiter. Then we have the acknowledge bit. This is very important, so I'll take a pause and repeat this. This acknowledge bit, it's sent by the transmitter with a receive bit on it. And the first node on the CAN network that sees the message, regarding if it is of interest of that message or not, shall put a dominant bit on the bus. If the dominant bit will not be on the bus, then we will have the acknowledgement error. So this is very important. If the dominant bit is received, then the controller will continue forger with the message and it will put the acknowledged delimiter, which is 1 bit. These delimiters, all of them are receive. Then we have the end of frame, which is 7 bits, which is also receive. Then we have the inter-frame space of 3 bits, which shall also be receive. And what's in front of start of frame and after inter-frame space is just the bus idle or the next bus message that will be transmitted. So this is how the data frame looks for a base type frame, how they name it, base frame format. Okay. Then we have the data frame of type extended. In this extended data frame, we have the 11 bits, which is the base identifier. Then we have a substitute remote request, which must be recessive. After that, we have the IDE, which stands for identifier extension bit, which will be sent with recessive. So it will not be an 11 bit, it will be a 29 bit identifier. Then we have the second part of the identifier, the extended identifier, which is 18 bits. And in the end, we have the remote transmission request, which must be dominant because it is a data frame. In the control field, we have two reserved bits now and the DLC. The data field is also of a maximum of 8 bytes, so we don't need to explain this further. I put here the note again about the acknowledgement bit. So let's go further. The remote frame. This frame is used to request a message on the bus. So how do we request a frame? We shall specify the identifier that we want to receive. We shall put here the recessive bit in the RTR. And very important, the DLC shall be of equal length to the expected response message. Otherwise, the arbitration will not work and the node will not receive anything. We need also to have nodes configured to respond to remote frames. Error frame. This is a special message that violates the framing rules of a CAN message. We will see how, because of these 6 bits of the same value. So it will violate the byte stuffing rule, and it's composed of the error flag and the error delimiter. The error frame will destroy the bus transmission, so every node will start sending error frames until the faulty one will go in bus off and it will be offline from the bus. Next, we have the overload frame. It is similar to the error frame. It's not used very often, but what this tells the bus is that the node that sends this overload frame wants a bit more time to process the last message received. So it is a slower node that process the message more slower, and it needs more time, so it will send this overload frame until it has finished processing the previous message. So that's why you will not see it used very often, because you will not have the real-time communication that you want on the bus. This is the end of part one. In the next lessons, I will continue with the points that are shown here. Until then, if you find this video useful, consider giving it a like. And consider subscribing to my channel if you aren't already. And share with your colleagues and friends. Channel, maybe they will find some things useful on my channel.